Our next reader tonight, I've had the pleasure of performing with recently here in San Diego on two separate occasions, and was just wowed both times. And she just informed me that she's going to be reading a piece tonight that she wrote expressly for you tonight. Woo! Expressly for her. Ladies and gentlemen, Troy Rowe.
I think that's short enough. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four beasts. And I looked and behold, a pale horse. And his name that sat on him was Death, and Hell followed with him. I find that line so captivating because I have never associated death with either heaven or hell. I grew up in a temple as a young child with a grandfather, a Buddhist monk, that did not hide the fact that he was dying. It wasn't imminent, but he knew he was running out of time. Laying in bed, wearing a charcoal gray linen kimono, he often said to me with a smile that he would be gone soon and that everything will be all right. He presented death as a practical and gentle process. And from him, I had learned not to fear death. I was especially close to one of my uncles. Uncle Kazu answered questions with consideration, trying to explain in ways I would understand. I was confused about the changes happening to my grandfather. I didn't understand why he could walk or talk on some days, but not on others. One day, my uncle pointed to a light bulb. What happens to a light bulb after a while, Akoi? It goes dim and stops lighting up. He patted my head. People are like that too. We stop lighting up, but we can't be replaced like light bulbs. It's a natural process of life. I believed him, just like I believed my grandfather. The day finally came when I woke up and found my family unexpectedly at the temple. I peeked into my grandpa's room, and he was breathing very, very quietly. My much older cousin, Mako, was put in charge of looking after me. He took me out to the park to play. He asked, "Do you know what's going on with Grandpa?" I replied the best that I could. "Grandpa's light bulb was about to burn out, but Uncle told me it's okay, that it's nothing to be afraid of." He put me on his lap while he lit up a cigarette. He asked me if I knew what happened when people die. I shook my head. My cousin finally said, "You're a smart kid." He went over to a metal trash can, tossed the match into a pile of paper inside. As the paper burned, he asked if I could feel the air getting warmer. I nodded. He asked me to touch his arm. "My arm's warm, isn't it?" I nodded. "That's energy, boy." He paused. "What will happen to that piece of paper?" "It'll go away." That's what's kind of happening to Grandpa. "You see, kiddo, he had a piece of paper over there, and it didn't get warm till it was set on fire, right? Energy doesn't go away. It changes. That paper was fuel for the warmth, and it may no longer be there, but it changed into energy you can feel. When you boil water for Grandpa's tea with Grandma, the steam. That's water getting hot and dispersing into the air because the kettle just can't contain it anymore. The water inside isn't gone. It's just changing form. I must have looked confused. I muttered something about turning invisible. He laughed. We don't turn into air. The body remains just like the kettle. But the fuel that makes us warm, walk, talk, run, that changes. That part of us, it becomes a part of everything, like steam becomes part of air. That part of us becomes energy you can feel but can't see. The next morning, by the time I woke up, Grandpa was already in his casket. I went up to Mako and asked him about the big wind box. He said, "We'll get to that later, but let's go get you ice cream first." When we returned, the room was empty. He led me to the casket. Grandpa was sleeping, but no longer breathing. I asked, "Is Grandpa's light bulb out?" He nodded. "Can I touch him?" My cousin said Grandpa would probably want me to hold his hand. I told Grandpa he was cold. Mako patted my head and asked if I had any questions. At that moment, I understood. I vaguely remember the actual funeral. So many people. Before the funeral started, I lurked, waiting for the room with the casket to empty out. When it would, I would scurry and talk to Grandpa, then scurry out as people walked in. During the ceremony, everybody was so preoccupied that I managed to slip away and spend part of his ceremony behind a huge temple bell, playing with the snakes that gathered there, and picked a few strawberries to eat. I asked out loud while chomping on some strawberries if Grandpa could taste them now. I could see people saying goodbye with family walking back into my grandma's house, and I slipped back in hoping people would notice my absence. Uncle Kazu-san saw me, picked me up, and gave me a shoulder ride for being a good girl and staying out of trouble. I nodded quietly as he carried me back inside. Later that night, I found my grandmother in her room crying softly, holding her prayer beads. I crawled up to her and put my head in her lap. She gently held me for a while, then asked me how I was doing. "Grandma, Grandpa isn't gone. He's something we can feel now, but can't see. He's everything and everywhere." My grandmother smiled, told me I was smart, and held me for a long time. After all, Grandpa was now everywhere and everything, and that sounded like a wonderful thing. So that was my first true introduction to death. And to a degree, it has continued to influence how I still view the process. And so I looked, and behold, a pale horse. And his name that sat on him was Death. And peace followed with him. Thank you.